Assalamu alaikum class. Today we are going to discuss a very important topic of biostatistics, which is standard error. We have already discussed the normal distribution and the phenomena which is associated with standard deviation and how the data gets dispersed around the mean in a normal distribution curve. Then we have discussed that what is the significance of z-score and how it helps us to interpret things in relation to the difference of each observation around the mean. So today we are going to discuss the standard error. So learning outcomes of today's lecture are that we will be discussing the difference between standard deviation and standard error. And then we will be calculating the standard error of mean and standard error of proportion. Let me emphasize again that whenever we talk about means and standard deviations, it means we are dealing with quantitative data. The quantitative data can be numerical data, it can be discrete, it can be continuous. Whenever we talk about standard error of proportion, it means the researcher is dealing with qualitative data. The qualitative data can be categorical data, it can be nominal, it can be ordinal. Fine, this should be very clear in your minds before we start, before we move forward with the standard error, because if this concept is not clear to you, you will not be able to understand this lecture. So I'm repeating again that standard error of mean is calculated for quantitative data and standard error of proportion is always calculated for the qualitative data. So now let's go back. That what do we mean by standard deviation and how it differs from the standard error? Let's assume that this is a total population, and from this population, the researcher has taken a sample. From this sample, the researcher has done many observations, and these observations are done in terms of quantitative data, which is numerical data. And each observation is presented with the alphabetical presentation of X. It means each individual value in a sample is presented with X. Whenever we want to calculate the mean, we will calculate all the number of X's. We will combine them together. We will sum them together. And then we will divide them by the total number of observations which have been made. It will give us a mean of the sample. And the mean of the sample is represented by X bar. Now, as a researcher, we want to know that how much each observation differs from the mean. How much each observation differs from the mean in the sample, how far it is distributed in a normal distribution curve around the mean, how far it is dispersed. And if we want to calculate the dispersion of each observation around the mean, we want to calculate standard deviation, which we have discussed in detail in our last lectures. Moving forward, if we talk about these samples, which are actually quantitative observations, each mean has its own standard deviation. There will be one standard deviation of the whole sample, but for each observation, there will be its own standard deviation. Fine. So if we want to calculate that what is the difference of mean and standard deviations within the sample of different observations, we want to calculate standard error. Fine. So in standard deviation, we want to know that what is the dispersion of each observation around the mean. But standard error tells us that what is the dispersion of standard deviation of each observation from the standard deviation of the population, which will give us standard error. Okay, let's move forward. So how will we define standard error? Standard error is the variation in standard deviation of different samples in the same population. So look at this. If I divide them, that this is the population, these are the multiple samples, and each sample has its mean and standard deviation, then how much these standard deviations in different samples differ from each other in a population will be represented by standard error. So how do we calculate standard error? Standard error is calculated by standard deviation of observation in a sample divided by the number of observations in the sample. So if we take the standard error, it will tell us that how much the standard deviation in different samples differ from each other in the same population. Okay, let's move forward. When we talk about the population is presented with capital P. The population has its own mean, which is represented by mu. And the population has its own standard deviation, which is presented by sigma. Now, if we take a sample in this population, the sample is represented by small n or s, then the sample mean is represented by x bar, and the sample standard deviation is represented by capital S or SD, which is standard deviation. So whenever the symbols come to you, you have to know that whether we are talking about the population, population mean, and population standard deviation, or we are talking in terms of the sample, sample mean, and standard deviation. Now, a researcher wants to know that how much the sample mean is different from population mean. How much the sample standard deviation is different from the population standard deviation, because it will help us to identify that whether the sample is representative of the population. Can we take the conclusion which is drawn from the sample, can be generalized on the population? Is this a significant difference or is this an insignificant difference? So standard error, if the multiple samples are taken, then the standard error of difference between two means and standard error of difference between two proportions is taken depending upon the type of data with which you are dealing. For example, if you want to know that how much the sample mean difference from the population mean and how much the sample standard deviation vary with the population standard deviation, you will calculate standard error of mean. And if you want to know that how much the samples which are taken from one population differ from each other in terms of sample means and standard deviations, you will take standard error of difference between two means. Fine. Okay, let's go to the population proportion, which is always calculated for the qualitative data. If we are talking about the proportion of a single sample, then we will be taking as the standard error of proportion. As one population and one sample and we are dealing with qualitative data, then we will be taking standard error of proportion. And if in the one population like this, the two samples are taken and two proportions are taken, then we will be dealing with the standard error of difference between two proportions. It must be very clear in your minds. Okay, let's move to the first test of significance, which is known as standard error of mean, which is taken when a researcher has taken a sample from the population and he wants to know that the sample mean and sample standard deviation are reflective of the population mean and population standard deviation or not. Can we generalize the results which have been brought from this with this results? And are these results significant or insignificant? So the formula to calculate the standard error of mean will be standard error is equal to standard deviation over under root n. It means the standard error will be taken by the standard deviation of the sample 1, which is taken from the population, divided by the sample size, and which is taken into under root. This is the formula to calculate standard error of mean. This can be sigma over under root n. It can be SD over under root n. So any type of presentation can come to you for the calculation of standard error of mean. So let's go towards the calculation. A sample of 25 males was taken and their mean temperature was 98.14 Fahrenheit with a standard deviation of 0.6. What is the true mean of the population? Very easy. The first question which will come into the mind of the researcher will be that whether we are dealing with qualitative data or quantitative data. So we are dealing with the mean temperature. It means it's a quantitative data. It's not a discrete data. It's a continuous data because we have a decimal into it. We have the value of mean. We have the value of standard deviation. We have the value of sample size. And now we want to calculate that whether the mean temperature which has been calculated on this sample is a true reflection of the population mean or not. So what will we do? We will take the standard error, and as the formula tells us that the standard deviation divided by the under root of the sample size will be calculated and it will give us a value of standard error. And once the standard error is given to us, then we want to calculate the standard error of population. Standard error of population is equal to sample mean plus 2 into standard error. This is not the population mean. We want to calculate standard error of population. So this is the sample mean, which was already given to us, plus minus 2 into standard error. As we were calculating the 95% confidence interval with the standard deviations, now we are calculating the confidence limits with the help of the standard error. So 98.14 plus minus 2 into 0.12. Why we have taken the standard deviation of 2? Because we want to be 95% confident. If I'll say that I want to be confident about 99% that this sample mean is same as the population mean, I will use the value of 3 into standard error. But now, ideally, it is said that 2 standard error and 2 standard deviation will give you 95% confidence interval, and the researchers are mostly okay with it. So we will be using 95% of confidence interval for plus minus 2 standard deviation and standard error. So sample mean plus minus 2 into standard error will give us a range of 95% confidence interval that the population mean temperature will lie between 97.90 98.38 degree Fahrenheit. Fine. So with a sample which is taken from a population, if we know mean value, if we know the sample size, if we know the standard deviation, then we can calculate standard error. And on the base of standard error, we can calculate the 95% confidence limit. We can calculate 99% of confidence limit. If it is specified that you have to calculate 99% confidence limit, then you have to use into three standard error or three standard deviation. But if it is not written, ideally we use the 95% confidence interval and we range between plus minus two standard deviation and plus minus two standard error. So we can calculate the mean values of the population. Okay, moving forward now. Now we want to deal with a proportion. And proportion is always calculated when we are dealing with qualitative data. Qualitative data can be categorical, it can be nominal, it can be ordinal, as we have discussed in detail. The population is presented with capital P, but the population proportion is presented with small p. Sample size is presented with N. Sample proportion is taken with small p, and the difference of proportion is taken with 100 minus p is equal to q, or 1 minus p is equal to q. Fine. So this is the difference of the 100% minus proportion will give us the value of q. So the formula to calculate standard error of proportion will be, standard error of proportion is equal to P, which is the proportion of interest, into Q, which is 1 minus P, over N, which is sample size, whole under root, will give us the standard error of proportion of a sample. And by calculating this standard error of proportion, we can compare that whether this proportion is truly reflective the population proportion or not. So let's take the example. Proportion of males in a village is 52%. A sample of 100 males was taken, which showed a proportion of 40%. Draw conclusions about the sample and calculate range of the males in this sample with 95% confidence interval. So the first decision again is that whether the data given is qualitative or quantitative. So we are dealing with proportions of males, which is a qualitative data, and it is a categorical data, it is a nominal data. So in this case, we will be dealing with the proportion. And as there is only one sample, which is taken from the population, which reflects the sample size of 100, it means we have to calculate the standard error of a single proportion or standard error of proportion. So the proportion given is 52 in the village, and in the sample proportion is 40. And we want to draw the conclusions about the sample. So the formula will be 52 as it was presenting the proportion of the males in the village, 52%, and 100 minus 52 is equal to 48, divided by 100 is the sample size and whole under root. So this is the proportion of males in the population. And we want to know that whether our sample in which the 40% males were taken was a true representation or not. So Q is always 100 minus P, which is 48. This is the sample size. Whole under root will give us a value of 5. So what do we do for a proportion confidence intervals? We will be calculating the value of proportion plus minus 2, as we wanted to be fine with the 95% confidence interval, 2 into standard error of proportion. This is the population proportion plus minus 2, which is 95% confidence interval, into standard error. And when we will calculate it, the confidence limit will be that the sample should be ranging between 42 to 62 males. And if our sample has 40 males, it is not a true reflection of the proportion of males when we compare it with the proportion of males in the whole population or in the village. This is the interpretation. Okay, move forward. So now we want to talk about the two samples. If in a single population, two samples are taken by the researcher, then definitely the two samples will have different means. They will have different standard deviations if we are dealing with quantitative data. And if we are dealing with qualitative data, then the two samples will have different proportions. Now we want to know that is there any difference between the two samples which are taken? Or there is no difference between the two samples? And are they truly reflecting the population? So when we wanted to calculate the standard error of mean, I will go back because now again the sample 1, total number will be N1, sample mean will be X1, which will be sample bar, sample standard deviation, this is the sample 2, N2, sample mean X2 with the X bar and sample standard deviation. So when we wanted to calculate the standard error of mean with a single observation, with a single sample, our formula was standard error is equal to standard deviation of 1 over under root N1. If I take a square of this value, just to simplify the calculation, the standard error will be equal to standard deviation square over N whole under root. This is just to simplify the calculation. Standard error can be calculated in such a way that we can take the square of the standard deviation and we can divide them with the total number of sample size by whole under root. It will give us the same value of standard error. So now we want to calculate the standard error of difference of standard error of two means. So this is the standard error of difference between two means. Standard error is equal to standard deviation of sample 1 square over N1 whole under root plus standard deviation of sample 2 square over sample size of sample 2 whole under root. So again, the standard error of single mean was represented in a different way plus standard error of mean of the second sample, and they are added together to formulate the standard error of difference between two means. Let's go to the calculations. Mean weight of rural girls, the sample size was taken was 105 and the mean weight was 58.6 kg with standard deviation of 8.3. And another sample was taken which was of urban girls, and now the sample size was 101, weight was 56 kg mean weight and standard deviation was 6.2. Now the researcher wants to know that is the difference between the girls' weight is significant or it is just by chance. So now we have two samples, rural girls and urban girls. Rural girls sample size is 105, mean weight is 58.6, standard deviation is 8.3. The urban girls sample size is 101, mean weight is 56 and standard deviation is 6.2. So now by putting them into the formula, which is the standard error of difference between two means, now what we will get is the standard deviation of sample 1 and N1, which is 58.6 and 8.3, and sample size was 103. So this is the standard deviation of sample 1 square over sample size whole under root plus standard deviation of sample 2 whole square divided by the sample size whole under root. This will give, by simple calculation, this will give us this value. This will give us this value by squaring them. And then by calculating them, we have standard error of difference is, that is 1.014. So now we want to know that whether the difference is actually significant or not. So now we will compare standard error of difference with the z-scores. So what we will do, we will calculate the z-score, which tells us that the mean of sample 1 minus mean of sample 2 divided by standard error of difference. And this value gives us a value of 2.56, which means if the z value is more than 2, the difference is significant. If the z value is less than 2, the difference is insignificant. As a researcher, now your null hypothesis was that there is no difference between the mean weights of urban girls when compared with the rural girls. But your alternate hypothesis was that there is a difference between the urban girls and the rural girls. Fine. So you have calculated the standard error of difference between the two means. After calculating the standard error of difference between the two means, you will put the values into for the calculation of z-score. And once your z-score is obtained, you will interpret your results. If the z-score value is more than 2, the difference is significant. Yes, there is difference in the two samples. If the z-value is less than 2, the difference is insignificant. If the z value is more than 2, it means your null hypothesis is rejected and alternate hypothesis is accepted. And if z value is less than 2, it means the null hypothesis is accepted and the alternate hypothesis is rejected. So we will go back to the data and we will say that the mean weight of rural girls is more than the urban girls, and this value is significantly higher than the mean value of the urban girls' weight. Fine. So this is how we interpret the standard error of difference between two means. Let's move forward. Now we want to calculate the standard error of difference between two proportions. So again, the formulas will be, the sample size will be represented by n, sample proportion of sample 1 will be p1, and difference of proportion will be q1. And here on the second sample, the sample size is n2, sample proportion is p2, and difference of proportion will be q2. So standard error of difference between two proportions will be calculated as standard error of difference between two proportions is P1 Q1 over N1 plus P2 Q2 over N2 whole under root will give us the standard error of difference between proportions. Let's go towards an example. For example, a medical researcher thinks that the smoking can result in wrinkled skin around the eyes. He makes a hypothesis that smoking is related to the wrinkling of eyes. The null hypothesis will be there is no relationship between the two. The alternate hypothesis is that there is a relationship between the two. So a researcher recruited 150 smokers and 250 non-smokers to take part in an observational study and found that 95% of the smokers and 105 of the non-smokers were seen to have prominent wrinkles around the eye. Fine. This is the data. And following results were obtained. Sample size, smokers were 150 and non-smokers were 250. As you can see, 150 smokers and 250 non-smokers. And out of 150, 95 were having this problem.
of wrinkling of eyes, and 105 out of this 250 were having wrinkling of eyes. So we will be calculating their proportion of wrinkles. Proportion will be calculated by the 95 divided by 150 and 105 by 250. All those who are having the problem, out of all those who were smokers, will give us the sample proportion of wrinkles, which is P1. And all those who were having wrinkles, out of all those who were non-smokers, will give us the value of P2, which is non-smokers. So while calculating the standard error of proportion, we will calculate standard error of proportion separately. For smokers, it will be P1 into Q1. Q1 will be 1 minus 0.37. Fine. These values are in decimals, so you will be subtracting B from 1. If it is 63, then you will be subtracting it from 100 to get the value of Q1. So P1, Q1 over N1. Whole under square. P1, which is 0.4, P2, which is 0.42, Q2, 1 minus P2 divided by the sample size, N2, whole under root. The values are these, which are obtained by the calculations. So whenever we calculate P1, Q1 over N1, whole under root, plus P2, Q2 over N2 whole under root, then the value which is obtained is 0.0706, and which the researcher has said that this value is almost equal to 0.05. When we see the actual difference between the two proportions, this value is generated from the t-tables. And then if the actual difference between two proportions is seen, which makes the 0.63 minus 0.42, that is equal to 0.21, which is the actual difference. So how will we interpret the results? Difference between the sample proportions plus minus z score when the standard error of difference, which is the actual difference, was 0.21, plus minus 2, we want to be 95% confident. We want to generate 95% confidence interval. So we will take 2 into standard error, which was rounded to 0.05 for simplification. And then it will be equal to 0.2 plus minus 0.1. The 95% confidence interval is that it will range from 0.11 to 0.31. It will give us the 95 confidence interval. How will we interpret this 95 confidence interval? That going from the lower limit to the upper limit, it does not contain the value of complete zero. So we say that the difference seen in the study is significant. So we will reject the null hypothesis and we will accept the null hypothesis. Fine. So whenever we talk about the difference between two proportions, we will calculate the standard error of difference between two proportions. Then we will calculate the actual difference of proportion between the two samples, and we will find out with the 95% confidence limits and putting the value of standard error of difference, we will get the range of 95% confidence interval. If this range between lower confidence limit to the upper confidence limit does not contain the value of zero in it, it means the results have significant difference. So you have to reject the null hypothesis and you have to accept the alternate hypothesis. There is another way to interpret the standard error of difference between two proportions. You will calculate the 95% confidence interval for smokers, which is 0.63, the actual prevalence was 0.63 plus minus 2 into the value of standard error of proportion, which is this. So what you will do, 0.63 plus minus 2 into 0.394, which will give us the standard error of proportion among the smokers, and you will set up a confidence value, confidence limit of this value. This will give us the lower confidence limit and this will give us the upper confidence limit. And you can calculate the 95% confidence intervals for the non-smokers separately. And that was 0.42 plus minus 2 into the this value. 0.42 plus minus 2 into the standard error of proportion. And you will calculate the confidence limits of the non-smokers. The interval for the smokers starts from 0.55. And the interval for non-smokers finishes at the 0.48. So they do not overlap. If they will overlap, the results will be insignificant. If they will not overlap, it means the results are significant. If the results are significant, you will reject null hypothesis and you will accept alternate hypothesis. That yes, the smokers has more ability to produce wrinkles around the eye. Both the methods can be used. You can use separate methods for calculating the 95% confidence intervals for smokers and non-smokers. And you can always use the method of calculating the standard error of difference between two proportions. And then you can calculate the 95% confidence interval and you can look into the value of zero for the interpretation of the results. So this makes the conclusion of my lecture. Just to emphasize again, if the two confidence intervals of two proportions do not overlap, it means the results are significant. If they are overlapping, it means the results are insignificant. If the results are significant, you have to reject null hypothesis. Number two, if the confidence interval for the difference between two proportions does not contain zero, it means the results are significant. You can use both the methods. So, if I conclude today's lecture, we have covered what is standard error. We have covered why do we calculate standard error. What is standard error of mean? What do we mean by standard error of difference between two means? What is standard error of proportion? What is the difference between standard error of two proportions? What are the circumstances in which we calculate it? How do help us to accept or reject our null hypothesis? How do they reflect that whether the values are truly reflective of the sample or not? This makes the base of the inferential biostatistics. I have tried my level best to give you examples. I have tried to give you the complete explanations of calculations. And I hope that you have understood it. Even now, if you haven't understood the subject, you can come to me in my office and you can always discuss it with me that what are your problems. For the conclusion of this lecture, I will be posting an assignment and you have to submit that assignment in the allocated time. Thank you so much. I'm open to questions. I'm open to comments and suggestions and your queries. We are happy that you are coming and resuming your college again. So hopefully we will work together again. Thank you so much.